Welcome to video 38, Ribosomal RNA Stammers. The cytoplasm of cells is chock full of small particles called ribosomes. Here's an electron micrograph of them, multiple small dots, in this case spread along cell membranes. And the most abundant type of RNA in the ribosomes is ribosomal RNA, rRNA. This abundance makes ribosomal RNA much easier to study than messenger RNA. Here's a picture from video 11. We have a set of genes that contain the information for a set of proteins which, because of the amino acid building blocks they contain, have specific structures that bring about specific reactions, which generate characters in the organism containing them. To make the proteins, the information in DNA is first copied into RNA, messenger RNA, and then this messenger RNA is translated to specify the order of the amino acids in the corresponding proteins. By virtue of its abundance in the cytoplasm, ribosomal RNA was studied first, so we came to know much more about ribosomal RNA before we began to understand messenger RNA. So we have messenger RNA and ribosomal RNA, and messenger RNA works more by virtue of its sequence than by virtue of its structure, whereas ribosomal RNA works more by virtue of its structure than by virtue of its sequence. Here's a picture of one folded ribosomal RNA molecule. Surprising though it may seem, this is just one strand. It begins just here, where there's one end called the 5' end, and it ends just here at the 3' end. And as you can see, if we go in from this end, it's just a single chain which curls round and forms a stem and various loops, and this goes on and on in a fantastically complicated way until we get to the 5' end. And this is only a two-dimensional representation. The three-dimensional representation would be even more complex. What's that? What do ribosomes do? Well, we'll be getting to that. But first, let's be clear that although both types of RNA, messenger RNA and ribosomal RNA, contain sequential information, the primary job of an mRNA sequence is to program the synthesis of another molecule, to program the sequence of a protein molecule. Whereas the sequence function of ribosomal RNA is structure. Its sequence has to program its own structure. So this is a fundamental difference between these two types of RNA. That doesn't mean to say that some structure is not important for messenger RNA, but its primary role is that of sequence. If you're prepared to accept this, then you can skip ahead. Otherwise, here's a brief word on thermophiles. Thermophiles. These are microorganisms that normally live at high temperatures. And we don't mean the temperatures you might find in your local Turkish bath or at hot yoga. Thermophiles are found near volcanoes, hot springs, or thermal vents in the ocean floor. Some can survive boiling to 100 degrees Celsius, boiling water. Since the early environment of the Earth is thought to have been at a very high temperature, then some people think that these thermophile organisms might be representative of some of the very earliest life forms. Now, such high temperatures threaten to disrupt the structure of the molecules thermophiles contain. So to exist in a thermophile, a molecule must be super stable. Now, as we saw in video 11, the structure of nucleic acids is largely due to stacks of paired bases, rungs in the DNA ladder. A pairing with T for DNA, or A pairing with U for RNA, and G pairing with C for both DNA and RNA. And it is the strength of this bonding, which is important for the structure of the molecules that contain these bases. In the case of ATAU pairs, the strength of bonding is relatively weak, whereas for GC pairs, the strength of the bonding is strong. And this has structural implication. AU and AT bonds are of low importance for structure, whereas GC bonds are of high importance for structure. And this has implications for the stabilities of messenger RNAs and ribosomal RNAs, as they occur in organisms growing at 37 degrees and at much higher temperatures. Both of these RNA species can be either relatively AU-rich or relatively GC-rich. For messenger RNAs in organisms which operate at normal temperatures, we sometimes find some which are AU-rich and some which are GC-rich. For messenger RNAs of organisms which are operating at much higher temperatures, again we find some messenger RNAs are AU-rich and some messenger RNAs are GC-rich. And since AU-rich messenger RNAs can function perfectly well at high temperatures, we can therefore assume that their structure is not critically important for that function. This is different when we get to the ribosomal RNAs. For organisms living at 37 degrees, some ribosomal RNAs are AU-rich and some are GC-rich. But when we come to thermophiles, we find that always, their ribosomal RNAs are GC-rich. There are no AU-rich ribosomal RNAs in thermophiles. So microorganisms that live at normal temperatures can have ribosomal RNAs rich in A's and U's, but thermophiles cannot. What's that? Why should this be? Well, the most likely explanation is that without the contribution of GC pairs, the molecules would lose their structure and hence their function, so that the organisms would die. So there is a constant selection pressure for thermophiles to keep their ribosomal RNAs GC-rich. This pressure doesn't operate in organisms that live at lower temperatures. Now, back to ribosomal RNA and your question about ribosomes. Ribosomes. Here are some amino acids, and the amino acids are joined together to make proteins. And ribosomes are the cytoplasmic particles that, largely by virtue of their complex structures, provide the work benches where proteins can be assembled, synthesized from their amino acid building blocks. Here you see ribosomes threaded together along a messenger RNA molecule. The ribosomes themselves consist of various proteins and, what is our present interest, three RNAs, ribosomal RNAs. Biochemists can isolate these three ribosomal RNAs from the ribosomes of organisms like you and me, and then separate them by virtue of their size. One RNA is middle-sized, about 1,900 bases long. Another is small, about 160 bases long. And the other is large, about 5,000 bases long. And these are present in equal proportions, so that for every medium-sized ribosomal RNA, there's one small RNA and one large RNA, about 1,900 bases, 160 bases, and about 5,000 bases. And together with the ribosomal proteins, these are assembled to make ribosomes. So these highly structured ribosomal RNAs curl up with highly structured ribosomal proteins to generate a very complex workbench upon which proteins can be manufactured. Now, since the cell cooks up its RNAs by copying DNA information, you might imagine there'd be a gene for each ribosomal RNA type. So we'd have a gene here for the medium-sized ribosomal RNA, and another gene somewhere for the small-sized ribosomal RNA, and another gene here for the large-sized ribosomal RNA. But since the cell needs to get these three types of ribosomal RNA present in equal proportions, it might make sense for the cell to join these three genes together. So to get rid of any intermediate segments and bring the three together. Move this one across and this one across, and then the cell might make one long parental precursor RNA, and then process these by clipping to give three RNAs that will be present in just the right proportions to form ribosomes. Indeed, this seemed to be the story emerging in the 1960s. Okay, you fellows, clip clip, off to the cytoplasm with you. Cozy up to those nice ribosomal proteins. But there turned out to be an added, quite fascinating wrinkle. The DNA segments corresponding to the three RNAs actually are dispersed in a large parental segment of DNA. They're not close together. So we're back to square one. The genes for the three RNAs are dispersed along one parental segment of DNA. And the whole segment is first copied as one precursor parental RNA. Then the three ribosomal RNAs are clipped out from this to give our three mature ribosomal RNA species, and the other bits, referred to as spacers, are destroyed. So ribosomal RNA stammers, okay, you fellows, attention there, 1900 clip, 160 clip, 5000 clip, off to the cytoplasm with you. What's that? Yes, as far as we can tell, the ribosomal spacers have no role whatsoever. They're just destroyed. They're there by default because they exist in the DNA from which the big parental RNA was copied. What's that? Why do spacers exist in the DNA? Well, that's a key question that we'll be getting to in future videos. But first, a word on the technology that led to the intron breakthrough. For that, we go ahead to video 39.